Dad, I appreciate you letting me interview you so you can share with your children, grandchildren, and all those descendants of yours who are to come about your parents and their parents, about your childhood, about your school days, about growing up on a farm as a small boy. Would you be willing to talk to your progeny about this for a while?
I'll be very happy to. We have Chandler biannual reunions, so we are gathering about 50 people, so maybe we'll share some of the videos for our family.
That would be very good. And then your grandchildren can have this to pass on to their children and grandchildren. Okay. So if I may, I'd like to start with asking about your parents and their parents. Can you tell me what you can remember about your mother's parents?
They came early, about 1860. They came to Ellis Island, and they went to Minneapolis on the train. Then they found a homestead up in Grigla, Minnesota. So they got a good lot, a good farm right on the main road to Grigla. So they were early settlers in the North Midwest.
And what were their names?
Their names in this country were Nomeland, but they came from Nomeland, so nobody knows what their Norwegian name was. That they took the name Nomeland because the immigration people could spell that.
And what were their first names?
Grandma's names was Jorland.
Jorland.
Yeah, and her husband is Sigurd. Sigurd.
And they were Norwegian farmers on the northern plains.
You bet. You bet. They had 160 acres right on the main road, and they were just subsistence farmers. They had milk cows and raised grain.
What kind of house did they live in?
Sigurd was a good builder, so Sigurd built a little house, a little cabin, but they expanded because they had 8 children.
Okay. And what was your mother's name?
My mother's name was Tony, T-H-O-N-N-I-E, Tony.
And so she grew up in Grigla, and how far did she get in school?
Well, she was an educated person. She was a nurse. She went to the 8th grade. Very few people went to high school in those days. But as a teenager, she was a doctor's assistant. So she was rode around the doctor in his horse and buggy and helped deliver, make house calls and deliver babies. So she was a very smart, competent lady.
So she was counted as well-educated. Was she also a midwife?
Yeah, she was a midwife, yes. She worked with the only doctor in town. She did everything that's necessary.
Good for her. And what did she enjoy doing?
Well, she was so busy having children, so she spent most of her life in the kitchen.
I imagine. Your father's parents, where were they from and what were their names?
Aaron and Ida. They were some upper class Swedes. They were some Dalmas in Sweden. And my sisters went back there a few years ago. They found their family relations that lived on the farm dated to the 1600s. So when my Swedish grandparents came over, they were very just young, maybe 18 or 20. So they have a homestead land near Grigla, about 3 miles out. But Ida, my grandmother, was a very strong, upspoken lady. She has, he's like a lot like Swedes. I was a helper, but I didn't like their summer chores because my mother used to pick berries all over. So I had to pick berries. It's so boring. We pick blueberries and currants and cranberries. We had high bush cranberries all in our farm gold and nuts. So I picked the berries and nuts. That one time we had to stay out of the woods, but there was a bear in there. When I was 12 or 13, I took my rifle and I tried to chase that bear. I could see its tracks in the grass above, but I thought, well, I started thinking, what if I find him? So I turned around and back. I think want to get in a fight with the bear. He might win.
He might win. So your family had 400 acres. Part of it was bog or swamp, and so there were ducks and geese that came through. Could you ever ice skate on it?
You bet. They called it a burnout. So it's peat bog. So lightning struck a fire, and it burned all year round. In the winter, I see a small kind of, but the peat bogs are 8 or 10 feet deep sometimes. But in the spring, it filled up. Then we ice skated in the peat bogs.
Mm-hmm. And that's where you got at least some of the cranberries and some of the fish and sometimes other berries. But you also had a woodlot, and that was the forest, right?
Yeah.
You had a woodlot.
Yeah.
And how many acres was that forest that was on your land?
I think maybe about 5 acres. We had tall eucalyptus trees. But the Coles used to sell, and I have a single shot 22. I used to hunt Coles, but my mother didn't want me to shoot anything with my six shot or in birds or animals and on the house. She was smarter than I was. So anyway, we had all kinds of trees. I don't know how they. Many varieties of nuts and berries. I don't know if we planted them or whatever. In the fall, I will go out and collect nuts and big bag of nuts. I spread them on my floor up on the library and dry them. So I used to go up and eat my nuts and read them, but I kept warm because I had a lion's skin that I wrapped around myself. So our relatives in the state of Washington sent a cougar hide when here. So we wrapped on it and the box that I picked and reading Ivanhoe and whatever.
Very good. It sounds like you had a lot of happy times in your childhood.
I did. I didn't realize at that time, but we were one of the very lucky people. They didn't freeze in the winter time, and we had looms to expand. But I lived in the same room for 17 years. So when I left home to join the Marines, when I have an own apartment, I decorated it on my own way, but I had a good size, a good place to live, and a good family.
And your family, were kind of scattered around the country, but they were very close when you were a child. Didn't you have a lot of family gatherings at your house?
Well, we did. Many people were drop in and see. My father was only child, but my mother has all these brothers and sisters. We had a lot of company with her cousins. They would come over and they would stay, and my mother would make sure that they were all fed well, and Dad would entertain us. So we had a very social gathering.
That sounds like you learned to enjoy that, and you still enjoy that, don't you?
Yeah.
Tell me about your sisters and brothers. Did you play a lot with them? You have one younger sister.
Yeah.
Tell us about your brothers and sisters. You said that Alex, the oldest, was 12 years older than you. And then who was the next in line?
Yeah, Edith. She was two years longer than Alex, but she was a smart one. She went to normal school after high school for a year. So she became a teacher, and she taught in our local school. She taught me to read. So she was a very fine lady and good teacher, and she was a itinerant teacher. And she taught in country schools for quite a few years, and stayed at the in the house of one of the students' parents. Mm-hmm. But she made as much as $50 a month.
She made good wages for those years. And who was the next child?
You know, so Mert, I talked to her last night. She's 88 now. She was a fine young lady. She married Bernard, and they have three fine sons. But my sister is soaring her age like I am. She can't hear very well, but I talked to her last night. I talked to one of her sons, Lynn. So we communicated. She remembers things that I knew, things that I didn't know. So she's doing all right. She's had her husband is 90 some. Mm-hmm. So my older brother is Elvin. So he was my best friend. And
when you were growing up, when you were children,
yeah,
he was your best friend?
He was about 12 or 13. He got blood poisoning, and he was in the hospital. He came out with a stiff hip. He walked with his side. So I learned a lot about caring and helping people from him, because from the time he was out of the hospital, I've always helped him. So she was a smart young man, but he didn't ever go to high school. But he was a willing worker and a fine man. But when he couldn't walk in the snow, he couldn't lift up. So he left home as soon as he could. He got a job in Minneapolis as a dental technician. So he was very successful, but he died when he was about 25 or so with Bright's disease. That was the saddest time of my whole life.
So, but when you were kids, when you were small children, you and he played together. And how about your little sister Mabel? Did she tag around after you and your brother?
Well, she did. But Mabel was still good looking, but she was very cute. So she was, I think she was a pet at home. But she, a nice young lady. We had a lot of good times together. So we went to high school together, and she was married very well. She married John, who was an engineer. And they lived in New to Reading, Eureka. That's why I think that's why I came here, to be near my sister Mabel.
You folks grew up on the farm, but none of you wanted to stay on the farm. Was it, even though you had a nice house and you were always warm, had plenty to eat, but was it that the winters were too long, or the work was too hard, or what was it that led you all to move away from the farm.
Mabel was still there when I left, but I didn't feel right at home, because I don't like repetition and don't like to do the same thing all the time. So when you milk one cow, that's enough. So we have to do it 12 times a day. So I could visualize living on the farm, but the war broke out. And so I graduated in high school at 1945. So all the talk was about war and enlistment. So my buddy Ray and I decided to join the Marines. So we don't want to get an education. So we went into the Marines to get a GI Bill.
And you did, and you got your master's degree eventually, and you taught for many years, but you were never tempted to go back and take up farming. So how is it now that you live on a little farm?
Well, I have a farm my size. It's about as big as this room. I have a covered deck built by your son, Danny, and you. So I have a mini farm. I have you used to have carrots, but I distressed to flowers. Now I have a very managed control place where I can get my hands dirty.
You get your hands dirty, but you don't have to go out in the 20 below weather to do it.
No, I've seen all the snow on the. I went to college in Chicago in the snow. My first school was in Elgin, Illinois. I fought for 4 years there, and I have enough snow to last my life.
Dad, thank you very much for talking with us and sharing stories about your family and your childhood. Thank you again.
It's my pleasure.
Come on.